rainy night. It's good to be here. What's up, San Francisco?
We'll have a conversation about the book. Before we do that, I was going to ask Patrick to read from the book for a little bit. And I think you were just going to read from the beginning, but if you want to set it up with any sort of context, please do.
No context. We'll just start at the start. Part one. Getting out of prison. Maybe I will do the mic.
Hello?
Getting out of prison is like having a rotten tooth pulled from your mouth. It feels good to have it gone, but it's hard not to keep touching at that hole. Raymond Gaspar served 4 years this time. He served them at a place in Tracy called the Dual Vocational Institution, DVI. The only vocation he learned was making sure the drugs kept moving. By the time he was done, he'd become something like a football coach. He told the players where to stand, what to do. He wasn't the head coach. That would be his boss, a man named Arthur. Raymond fell in with Arthur because one of his uncles used to associate with him. As soon as Raymond got bounced from San Quentin up to DVI, his uncle told him to find a man named Arthur. Don't worry, he said. There'll only be one Arthur on the yard. That ended up being true. Arthur smiled big when he heard who Raymond was. Turned out, Arthur was a good man to know at DVI. He was big business, and not just there either. He kept a low profile, but his fingers stretched well beyond the yard. He associated as white, but he dealt with blacks and Latins too. As far as Raymond knew, Arthur was the only man in the California Department of Corrections who could make a call to the Black Guerrilla family or the Aryan Brotherhood and get action from either group. That's how he was. Raymond had been locked up for trying to sell a stolen boat to a man in San Francisco. He had walked right into a police investigation that didn't have anything to do with him. It was simple bad luck. They wrapped him up outside the garage on 6th Street. When the cops searched his car, they found an ounce of crystal meth. It was a bad day. They had him on tape talking about the boat, which led them to the boat itself back in the garage in Richmond, and they had the drugs. 2 months later, his public defender, a good lawyer, lost the motion to suppress at the preliminary hearing, and Raymond was forced to take a deal. 4 years. Arthur must have thought that stolen boat made Raymond something of a businessman. He kept him off the front lines, didn't use him as muscle, and right off the bat made him a supervisor. It was a fine thing to be doing. Make the rounds, see where things were with the supply, let Arthur know that everything was good. Didn't have to touch the dope, and he didn't have to play rough either. Raymond swore he saw a shine in Arthur's eyes when he reminded him that his release date was approaching. It was uncharacteristic. I got a little situation you could help me with, the older man said. They were sitting near the handball courts in the south yard. A few of Arthur's men sat near them. Arthur was a big man with a big head and big shoulders. He sat hunched over with his elbows on his knees. In his country accent, he'd been raised on a horse farm in western Colorado, explained that he had a little side thing going in San Francisco. I got this lady that buys a little pack of Molly every month and sells it to this other dude. 30, 40, 50 pounds a month, real weight. I set it up, everything's good. She cuts me a little percentage off the deal each time. He made a gesture like he was flicking water off his hands. Raymond wanted to ask what kind of percentage, but he didn't. Arthur told him anyway. Thing is, that 10% is not enough. He looked at Raymond like he was confirming his level of interest. Raymond nodded. What I'd like to do is replace at least one of these two parties with you. I mean, unless you're planning on going straight or some bullshit, accepting the Lord into your heart. Raymond shook his head. It's a complicated situation, though. Arthur went on. Can't just go and push a motherfucker out on this one. Made his face look like the very idea was distasteful. Nah, you can't just push him out. I want you to go there and acquaint yourself with the situation. It's hard for me to see everything from here. Pointed at the walls, turned and looked at Raymond. Go and look, Raymond asked. felt a sense of uneasiness come over him. That's it, Arthur said. Just go and look around. Get to know these little two skunks. See what's up. Do some of that fancy bullshit you do. Make sure the next deal goes through. I'll cut you half of my 10, put you at 30,000 or something around there. Let you land on your feet. After that, if we got to do the same shit next month, we'll drop it to a quarter of the 10, 2.5, put you at 15 or something. It's not bad. He smiled. Raymond did too. 15,000 a month was good. Arthur continued. Even if we don't make a move, it won't hurt to have you on the ground. You did your thing in there, man, and I still owe that fucking uncle of yours, so. He held his fist out. Raymond bumped it.
That's it. So that's that good.
They don't tell you that you gotta learn how to act. You know, when you write these things, that then you will have to perform it to people and do accents. And
it's, you know, it's never what you, much like the book itself, you don't quite know what you're getting yourself into.
That's right.
Much like the characters. Let's talk about that first before we get into the general conversation. So Raymond Gaspar is going to be this protagonist who's going to take the reader initially into this demimonde, San Francisco's very own mission district, but also extending out to Daly City, where we're going to meet various people. One of them is a matriarch of a crime family, Gloria Campo, I think. She was Filipina. We're going to meet some tech people. We're going to also meet some various people who work with Gloria, who Raymond is there to keep an eye on. But that just becomes the point of departure for the rest of the book, because then we're going to go from there. We'll wind up, and I don't want to get too much into it, because the book is beautifully and intricately plotted, and I don't want to give anything away, so I thought it might be safer just to talk about the characters themselves and various themes. But from there, we're going to go and see protagonists coming up in Israel, Miami, Cambodia, in various places. And the first thing I wanted to ask you was something that struck me about the book, that at the end of it, I was very exhausted in a good way. It's incredibly anxiety-producing. And it's incredibly anxiety-producing because one cares very much for the characters. And it's very easy to identify them through situation. But the one thing I took away from it, which I thought was really unique, was a sadness. There's a sadness that permeates this entire novel. And it's so welcoming, because when you read a lot of crime fiction, usually we're put in the position of following a protagonist who's wised up and knows all the answers. And if the person doesn't know the answers, they can kick her ass. It really doesn't matter. They can punch their way out of the situation. Or it's a world that's very cynical, where death and violence are just the cost of doing business, and you have this world-weary shoulder shrug. And so let me begin by asking, were you writing intentionally against that kind of worldview of crime writing?
Well, yeah, I think I was, actually, but maybe not with the sadness part of it, but I think the sadness just comes because maybe I'm a sad guy. It just comes out.
Well, what do you mean? I'll tell you what. For example, I think the sadness for me comes from the situation where you have these people who feel like they're in over their heads.
Yeah.
And, they just don't have the wherewithal, or they delude themselves into thinking they can figure this out.
Yeah.
But they don't.
Yeah, and they're kind of out of control. Like, they can't control what's going on around them.
And they're cognizant.
Yeah. So what you asked about going against, I don't think with the sadness I said that, but there are some things with going against the grain of normal thrillers, but that for me would be more, I think, with the idea of having good and bad characters and stuff, and having heroes and villains. With this one, I think I try to have just more where everyone's kind of, every man's a menace. Everyone's bad, just get rid of good characters and have only bad characters. No, but try to make the bad characters even into good characters. And that's our public, that's my public defender background of trying to give these characters, try to put their crimes and their bad acts in some kind of context. and understand why they would do the bad things that they do and try to mitigate the bad acts, you know? So I think that is kind of the goal of it. And then also I try to push against some of the tropes of crime stuff, maybe some of the larger issues of, you know, the female characters, and try to make them a little different than they are normally portrayed as.
Normally they're portrayed as?
Well, normally they're portrayed as, Rehan often points out that, you know, like the night of, on the TV show The Night Of, that the women just end up as dead people, you know, they're just like dead bodies, dead beautiful bodies that are covered in blood, you know, and not so, or, you know, they're victims, or even if they are bad people, then they're like over the top bad people, and they're like just evil, but, I mean, with all of them, I try to just make the characters seem more real, more human.
Well, they seem really, well, it's very easy to identify, they seem very average. And that's to say, you know, when you're reading the book, no one, except for, say, the character Shadrach, who's definitely eccentric, and for one other character who turns out to be a sociopath, everybody is identifiable as a human being. Not like in the sense of someone, you know, you would not perceive this to be an outlaw. Someone who, if you met them, you wouldn't think automatically, you know, they're involved in organized crime. In the book, their situations, and it's sort of an aside, but you kind of let people know that for a lot of them, it's about limited opportunity. I think with the case with Raymond, right? Well, explain Raymond, how did Raymond just wind up as a criminal, right? His mom is working, is a single mother working, she loses her job, and...
Yeah, she, I don't know if I remember it all exactly.
I do, I'll let you know.
The mom, yeah, Rehan, do you want to answer? yeah, Raymond's mom is working and she gets falsely accused of stealing from her restaurant's till, and she loses her job, I believe, and then Raymond doesn't get new clothes for school, and he ends up falling in with kind of the wrong crowd at his school in Santa Rosa, and kind of joins these bad kids and starts stealing cars, and you know, ends up in juvenile hall, just like one thing kind of leads to the next. But so then he's thinking back on, like, if my mom just hadn't been accused of that one thing, maybe my life would have turned out differently. But I had some new school clothes on that day and didn't end up with those few kids.
Now, as your experience as an investigator, a public defender investigator, are those the sort of stories you would come across? The people who you were, is working with, did they have similar type of situations where this is why suddenly they're looking at jail?
Yeah, I think definitely. You know, we have some public defenders in the house. Would you guys agree with that? Everyone's got a story, you know, whatever. If you're charged with a murder, you have a backstory. Mm-hmm. And some incidents happen to you, whether it's, you know, severe, like sexual violence against you, or it's a drug addiction, whatever it is, or it's some kind of family abuse. Most people that end up in these cases all have some kind of background that makes them not have great decisions. You know, I'm looking back at these lawyers whose cases I worked on that, I mean, we had some horrible backstories of people, you know? And they ended up getting charged with horrible crimes that they didn't commit.
Were any of those stories similar to the ones, there's two characters who are club owners in Miami via Israel, and one of them, they get involved essentially in the world of ecstasy smuggling because they want to make some money, not a lot of money. They just want some easy money. They're not looking to be violent. They're not looking, you know, to be a cop or none of that. But, you know, they see, you know, essentially what seems to be an easy way to make a lot of cash. Is that something that happens a lot in your experience?
You know, this stuff with the drugs, I've worked on some drug cases, but I haven't worked on that many drug cases like this book. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the drug stuff was just kind of made up.
But it's fiction, that's okay.
You can do that. I've worked on some drug smuggling, more in New York now, that I've now worked on some drug smuggling cases. But the drug stuff in this book was made up, but it's pretty easy to make up because with drug smuggling, people are doing it any way you can imagine. If you can imagine it, then they are doing it. So if you're writing fiction, you can kind of just make up whichever way you want to make it up.
And it's very plausible.
It can be plausible. I mean, people do crazy things. I've read about people attaching like little kind of leech. I don't know how to explain it, but you know the little fish that attach to whales?
Sure, yeah.
They attach like those kind of things to freight ships underneath the water. And then ship it under, then scuba divers go under the boat and grab it off the boat, and no one ever knew it was under there, you know, so.
Fish.
Huh?
Fish.
Not an actual fish.
Not an actual fish, yeah. They put it on a whale.
The fish is amazingly doped up. It's delicious. You eat it like sushi. It's phenomenal. But you did do research, though, for essentially the origins of the trade for ecstasy. In fact, you wrote about it in this essay of Lit Hub. Could you talk a little bit about that? Because that's probably the most unusual way I've heard of someone coming up with their book on the spur.
Yeah, well, I mean, I sold the first book and got a two-book deal. And then I called my friend Andrew, who's sitting in the back there, we were text messaging. I sent him a text message. Sorry, we got some latecomers in here. Welcome. Welcome, Sam.
We'll stop, it's okay.
Come on up.
You haven't missed a lot. We're just in red.
Thanks, everyone. Let's see. Great.
You just read. You talked a little bit about this map.
Yeah.
And you're good.
So I was text messaging with Andrew, and I said I got this two-book deal, and then he texted and he said, did you know that Molly comes from a tree in Cambodia? And I was like, no, I didn't know that, actually. And then I called him right then, and he told me a little bit more about that. I said, oh, that does sound like a good idea. But I was working on another book at the time, and it took place in prison at BVI, actually, which is a prison that Mark Iverson, a lawyer back there, and I visited a client we visited a witness there once. So that book took place in prison, and it was about these Aryan Brotherhood guys. And so I was working on that, and then the book deal happened, and I went down to meet the editor who had bought the book, and he asked what I was working on, and I said, I'm working on this thing, it takes place in a prison, and it's about these Aryan Brotherhood guys, and that he was like, do you have any other ideas? And then I just kind of winging it, and I was like, well, my friend just told me this thing about that ecstasy comes from a tree in Cambodia, and I'm like, you could have a drug dealer in San Francisco, and some traffickers in Israel that move it, and he was like, I think you should go with that one. I'll give you a little more money, I'll give you some money to go to Cambodia to research that one. And so then I agreed to it, and then I was driving back and realized that I just agreed to write a novel about Cambodian characters, which seemed crazy at the time.
And so you went out there. How long were you there?
I went for a month, and on the way there, I stopped at a friend's house in Brooklyn, and she said, you should rent a scooter in Bangkok. And I looked online, and then I was like, I can rent a motorcycle for the entire thing. And then I rented a motorcycle and drove it into Cambodia and around Cambodia for a month.
But in the end, so you wrote a third of the book was about set in Cambodia, right?
Yeah, so then I wrote the book, and a third of it took place in Cambodia and was about these guys that were logging the trees. They were Cambodians and Vietnamese people. I gave it to six people to read, who are in the audience here, and
and five of the six people were like, we love the book, but we do not love the Cambodian section. Not because it was bad, but they say it was bad. Because it felt disconnected from the other two sections, and the characters didn't interact with the other characters, so it just felt like a separate thing. And they were, you know, they were definitely right, and I can't believe that I thought that it was done when it was done. And so I had to get rid of that. That third of the book got boiled down to two pages. In Cambodia for two pages of dialogue, and I had to write a new third of the book, but the new third that I wrote wrapped everything up together and turned it into a masterwork.
Well, in that essay, in fact, you write that that still is the heart of the book.
Yeah, and it is the heart of the book, I think.
And is it that idea of just this sort of chain of interconnectedness that people are oblivious to?
Well, I think that in the book, without, I don't know if it's how I can talk about it without people knowing what it is, but the idea that the guy in the, they talk about that these guys who were logging the trees, one of them became crazy. Just the idea that, like, there was this curse in Cambodia that happened when they cut the tree down. Someone went crazy and someone got killed. It doesn't even matter because it's a small part of the book, but that curse was somehow, like...
rippled out.
Yeah, and it was, like, spiritual almost, or it was, like, a ghost or something. And it never talks about that explicitly, but just that idea that then everything from there, it's all bad coming out from there.
The other thing about the book, too, I found really interesting, I think find it interesting about when anyone writes about organized crime, is indeed how organized it is. You know, there's a sort of irony to people's perceptions of folks involved in that as being outlaws and mavericks, when the truth is, it's very conformist. It's not exactly the greatest job if you want to express your individuality.
Yeah, no, I think so. And I think people have talked about, I didn't necessarily think of this, but people have talked about the kind of middle class aspect of it, which I really like when they said that these guys, that some of these characters, it's not like the drug lords that have this like lavish lifestyle. These are much more kind of blue collar guys that are staying at, like Raymond is staying at an SRO in the Mission Street, on Mission Street. You know, he's not like a drug lord living in a mansion. There are these blue collar level people that work in the drug trade.
So I'm going to take another stab at the book's very similitude. There's one small part in the book where a corrupt investigator describes a scheme wherein he uses one of the protagonists to flirt with men in bars, men who happen to be going through a divorce, and who his basically spouses he's representing, or the lawyer who works for is representing, gets them drunk and then getting trapped for DUI. Now that happened out in Contra Costa County.
Yeah.
There was a guy who actually got busted for that.
Yeah.
And worse things, by the way, than that.
Right.
And so I wanted to ask, are there other similar true stories seeded throughout the book? For example, because I'm hoping it's true, because I find her character fascinating, Gloria Ocampo, is that based on someone or some situation?
I mean, in a way, just very vaguely, once when I was at the public defender's office, I think she was a victim. I can't even remember exactly, but she was an older Filipino woman, and she seemed kind of in some kind of criminal element. You know, she was talking about like those gambling dens.
Mm-hmm.
They were a little, in the book, they're like a little gussied up, you know, but she was talking about this gambling, that there are these poker machine rooms in San Francisco that are affiliated with like senior citizen centers, but they're really just like gambling spots. And so her, just the idea of her, it wasn't based on anything, but just that was like a tiny little nugget in my head.
And there's also the, and I guess this, I wanted to bring this up but I think I know what my answer is. At 1.2 in the book, one of the characters describes how Miami is blowing up, and there's all this money coming in. I know that was true in the 80s, when the Colombian cartels were working out there, and they had all these high rises that went up, and luxury car dealerships, and people literally bringing trash bags full of cash and making deposits. Is that going on now, or that's just now?
No, well, again, maybe I'm just taking things from everyone. People are telling me, and I'm just stealing it.
No, but please share.
We did have a friend in Hudson who bought a house in Miami, and he said that, the economy was going crazy, and that I stole it right from what he said, that banks were, welcoming people into the bank with champagne. And I think that was true at the time when I was working on the book at first, a couple of years ago, that they were having a little crazy real estate bubble that was, Russian, it was a lot of Russian money, and there was a lot of money laundering going on in real estate. And I don't know, it was unregulated in some way, I don't even know, but I just took that one from what he said. It was just a casual conversation.
It's all these details when you read the book that really resonate, because, I think this is why I felt this sort of sadness at the end, because it's way too easy to identify with how clueless everyone is. Sort of the world operates under this this overarching value of scam everybody. Scam everybody, keep them in the dark, let them be the last, let them find out what they have to know, at the last minute when they're screwed, it's too late for anyone to do anything about it. But, well, that sounds familiar. That kind of sounds like modern American living in terms of, you don't exactly know what you're getting, when you, with your job, you don't even know what industries are actually valued, what they're valued at, you don't know, all these sorts of things. Everything seems to be, a short-term game.
Yeah, it's a, it's a modern classic critique on the American capitalist system.
But yeah, why not? Because, Gene Zellroy, I don't think it's an idea unique to him, but he definitely expressed it. He said, if you want to know what's going on in society, particularly, in American society, read crime fiction, because that's where you're going to see how things are actually working or not working.
Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, I agree.
There you go.
I agree.
So you were born in San Francisco.
It's funny, my friend Bear is sitting here, and I used to fantasize about doing this kind of thing, giving a book reading, probably even before I started the first book. We were probably doing this 10 or 15 years ago, where I would play act that I was doing a reading. And say, yeah, it's great to be back in San Francisco. I was actually born at University Hospital. And we literally would do this every time we'd pass University Hospital. Great to be back in San Francisco.
And you worked at the public defender's office here for how long?
For 5 years at the public defenders, and then 4 years with a guy named Tim O'Brien. It's a struggle this year.
Did you, at one point in the novel, Raymond describes being in the mission, and he describes basically being unnerved, where he says it looks the same, but it's different, it feels richer. Now, you coming back to visit from the East Coast, you've been away for a little bit, does it feel the same way to you as it does to Raymond?
Of course. What do you think?
I don't know. I think it's 95.
That's crazy. The taxi drove us in on 6th Street over to Taylor, and we were at Taylor and Market, and there was a window you could see through, and there were techies working at the computers inside the window of some fancy building on Taylor and Market. I was just like, man, it's changed around here.
But yet that, you still have those same SROs. You still have a lot of those same elements. In fact, that's kind of what makes it, I think, stranger, is that these, obvious signs of desperation are still there, but yet, it's being eclipsed by all this wealth and all this, comfort and material.
Yeah, it's interesting. When I wrote The White Van, I made a conscious choice that I didn't want to address any of the techie stuff, and I just wanted to have the story be about the SROs more and the cops and stuff, and I didn't want any techie stuff. And then I got a criticism from a friend who said that was his one complaint. He was like, it's about San Francisco, and there was not a single line about the gentrification or the tech problem going on, and I think he was, it was maybe. I agreed with the criticism because it is a serious issue here, and so then I sprinkled in a few things here.
With a very frightening comeuppance towards the end. So let's
revenge. It was the final revenge.
It was indeed
acting out my revenge fantasies
in on paper, where it's safe.
Yeah.
Yes. Right. Yes. So let's open it up for questions. No one has. I guess because you know Patrick too well.
Give him a second.
So my name's Chase. I'm an old friend of Patrick's. I worked at the Public Defender, thanks in part to him. As soon as I showed up, he left. But I read the book, and I want to ask a question without hopefully giving anything away for those who have yet to read it. It seems like in this book, in contrast to your first masterpiece, police and policing plays a very, very small role.
Yeah.
They're pretty much not present at all.
Cops, really.
And I'm just wondering if you have something against the cops.
Well, I spoke my mind yesterday at the reading in Oakland, and I think maybe I was too candid. I don't know if I run for political office or something later, but yeah, San Francisco, I mean, everywhere it has corrupt cops, but even watching from afar, San Francisco is so funny. They're still going through it every time there's a new scandal that comes out, racist text messages, stealing from people in SROs, and these are the stories you hear about, you know, but they're so corrupt here and everywhere in the U.S. And there's, you know, there are some cops, probably a few good cops, you know, out of a sampling. There are good cops with good intentions, but there's a lot of bad cops, and I think there's a culture in policing where it's okay to lie and cheat, and that's just normal within the culture of places where they're just like, we will cheat and lie, and that's how we do it. And they think they're doing it for a better cause, to protect people, or I don't even know why they do it exactly, but I think there's a major problem.
Yes. No, that was a scratch to the head.
Yeah, please.
So, back to your statement about the part in Cambodia where you sent the text to like a few friends and they gave you feedback. Did your editor give you that feedback as well, since they were the one who even suggested going to Cambodia? Did they have a similar opinion?
Well, it's interesting because my editor at Grove, he's a great guy, but he runs Grove, so he can't edit it as closely as he would want an editor. So I got them to pay my friend Jordan, who's sitting there in front of you right there. And then Eli also helped. There's all these people I'm looking around. Chase, I read it, and was one of the earlier ones. Rayhan read it, and my agent. So I sent it to them. So I didn't send it to the editor, and thankfully, because I didn't want them to see that bad draft, if it was a bad draft, and it turned out to be a bad draft before I fixed it. Yeah.
But you take editing advice from all around, and that of your editor at the company is sort of weighted differently in a certain sense?
Well, I mean, I think I probably take it differently from different people, of course. You know, like Chase's, I'll probably take a little less. No, but, you know, and different people have different strengths and stuff, too. You do different, you know, you take it differently, and I won't take everything everyone says, but I am definitely open to suggestions. And in this case, I mean, I was open enough to get rid of a third of the book. I think I just take it differently. But when you share it with six people and five of them without consulting each other independently, tell you each that it's bad, and oh, my dad was one of the people too, and he said, I read it and I felt sorry for you.
I'm sorry.
That's what he said, because it was like so kind of missing the mark.
That's brutal.
It's brutal. But we're here, you know.
You're okay.
Carl Weissman's hyping it.
Yeah.
Wall Street Journal. Yeah. Dad doesn't know anything.
I'm not sure exactly what I'm asking, but you know, you're an experienced guy who had these experiences working here in San Francisco, and then you do your research in Cambodia. But I understand you work spontaneously a lot. So was there a big surprise for you as the novel evolved as to some character or where it went? Or what was the thing that sort of made you in your private moment in your room kind of go, oh, this is amazing?
Yeah, that's a good question.
I think it's like almost every, my whole, the way I approach the book is always, it's like a numbers game where I just try to write like different numbers, but between 500 and 800 words a day, really. And then so the big thing, if I can just do that every day, that would be a surprise. And then if those days add up and I have like 28 straight days where I've done that, then that feels like the good surprise. And then the plot, when plot things happen and things make sense, you know, that feels good when things click together and you're like, oh, I see that. But I don't know if it's like, I don't know how to answer it exactly in terms of this.
A twist in the book.
There's a lot of twists. And, I mean, it's very twisty.
That surprised you.
Well, they do. All of them surprise me because I don't plot it out. Mm-hmm. So it's all kind of surprises to me in a way, you know. And the way I think I get to it a lot of by trying to think, a lot of it is the twists. People say, how do you come up with these amazing twists?
Masterful twists.
This is a new routine that I just came up with. I don't do this every time, but I'm getting into it. But they say, how do you come up with these twists? And I think a lot of it is trying to answer questions of that thing about like the public defender kind of thing of why would they do this? That's where some of the twists come out of. When you start digging deeper into why characters would do something that they do, that's where I think where those twists come from.
You work a set routine? You go to work in your room from this time to this time, try to get those pages?
It's always changing. Like when I did the white van, I would park a white van from the public defender's office and write for an hour in the van during my lunch break. Handwriting in a notebook.
There you go.
And then I did most, like, 3/4 of the book that way. And then with this one, you know, when I started it, I was in Hudson and I didn't have another job, so I would have a pretty set routine then, work from like 12 to 3 and then go hit the gym and make a little food. And then now with this one, now I'm back in New York and I'm investigating again, so now it's about trying to carve out a little time in the morning. And Now I go over to a Pratt Library near our house and just try to work for like 2 hours. But
is working, is making it work for you, or would you like to get rid of that?
I think I'd like to not work. Yeah. Yeah, I'm lazy, you know. And private investigation is hard work, and it's traumatic and just like affects your soul and makes you a depressed person. But it's good. It's meaningful work, and I love it. Honestly, I'm being real. Like,
that was
like
a masterful twist.
I'm serious. I mean, these people here know that it's like gratifying work, but it can beat you down. It's like such hard work, but it's super meaningful, gratifying work. But man, that can take a toll on you. You know. And I served my time. I've been doing like 12 years now. So. But I have really good work that I'm getting into right now in New York, too. So.
Yes.
So it's been 9 years working as an investigator, and I have
12 years.
12 years. I'm assuring you. You must have an incredible number of stories that you've accumulated, as well as characters that you've met. When you were working, did you make character sketches?
Yeah, no, I don't really do character sketches or jot down like a little file on characters. I just try to like see them and hear them in my head, you know, just close eyes and try to picture them. And I can do it. It's like, I think that's what makes a fiction writer, maybe, is if you can do that thing where you can imagine it that way, you know, and see it in your head is what it's all about, kind of. But yeah, so, and then, you know, I take elements here or there.
Shadrach.
Yeah, Shadrach. The name Shadrach was one of our clients, one of Rebecca's clients that we worked on, a guy named Shadrach, and he has some characteristics that Shadrach had, you know. That Shadrach was interesting, and that Shadrach is interesting.
And then there's other, like, other elements that people say, and, you know, you just take it and mix it all together, and, but in my head, we're not making, like, files on people.
We did have a running list of future clients and people we came across that had great nicknames, so.
Yeah, we did. Yeah. I'm trying to remember some of them. Sleep Tight, that was my favorite street name, Sleep Tight.
Oh, yeah.
That's a good one. Space Jams. That's another good one.
Well, go ahead.
Yeah, you had a long one.
I have it in my computer.
Andrew's an investigator, and he has given me all my ideas on both of these books.
I'm getting pressure now. I'm going for the third.
I know. I need a third. A new one.
But did Sleep Tight enjoy sleeping?
I don't know what his deal was.
Killer.
Put people to sleep.
That would do it.
Are you working on
it? It was probably because his mom was like, Sleep Tight, and his friend probably heard him and was like, oh, Sleep Tight?
That would haunt you for years.
I don't know what it was, but that probably was it.
Space Jams.
Yeah, Space Jams. Probably like Space Jams. Yeah, he's like, I love Space Jams. You love Space Jams? You're Space Jams.
So that guy, he won't shut up about Space Jams. Let's just call him Space Jams. Best movie ever. It's coming out of you, by the way. You'll be really elated.
Leave a classic alone.
That's right. Leave the classic alone. Another question. You don't have to. You're not obligated.
Yeah,
I'll just tell you that right now. But, you know.
So, Patrick, did you have any kind of political orientation that you put into this story?
I mean, I'm a far left winger, and I'm, you know, into civil rights and all that stuff, but the truth of the matter is I try to keep it, the fiction, I try purposefully not to insert any politics into it.
Well, except that the whole story is very political.
Well, I'm saying I try not to insert politics into it, but politics will be there, I think, but I think it's better just to let it come out naturally than to be like, I'm going to attack this issue of drug laws or the criminal justice system, you know? Mainly I wanted to just do like a scary...
More is like, when I was reading the book, the whole question that kept coming up is, who is the one with the power? Where is the power?
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
They're all jockeying power.
Yeah, but is that a political question or a just a group dynamic kind of question? I don't know, is it?
No, I think about, when I think about the underworld, so to speak, and you made some comment at the very beginning about strategic capital.
Yeah.
And, you know, the criminal underclass, or the underworld, is really a metaphor for, it's pure capitalism.
Yeah.
Because it's unregulated markets.
Yeah.
Right? So it's pure.
I agree with it, but yeah, like I said, I purposely actually try to not approach it as a political thing, and then when the political stuff is there, I'm happy, but I don't attempt to do it. And I have faith that it will be, but not in an attempt.
There was a question in the back.
Are you a bi-coastal writer that is you sell books in the Midwest, or do you find, you know, what's the interest level as far as Mid-America, South, stuff like that?
It's catching on. It is catching on. Now, you know what's interesting? You know what is interesting, actually, is because they're thrillers, I feel like people actually, and it comes from a respectable publisher, you know? People do read it that I never imagined would read the book. So, like, Republicans in Kansas, like a 65-year-old Republican in Kansas, like, very easily could read the book because they're into thrillers. And thriller fans are, like, generally older people is the class. So I go to, like, these thriller conferences, and they're all senior citizens, and they're not people that I normally hang out with necessarily. There are people from the middle of America, and they read it, and some of them love it, and some of them, it weirds them out because it's darker than the thrillers they're used to, or it's just like different than what they're used to. It seems strange to them. But some of them are super into it. I've met people that like you wouldn't think would be. And it's interesting too, because all my friends here in San Francisco are like musicians and artists and stuff. section over there. And so I always grew up where the people that you made the stuff for were you would be performing for your own friends, kind of, you know, like your group of people. But the, and even if it was like a literary novel, I feel like those middle American people wouldn't be reading it if it was a literary fiction thing. They probably wouldn't be reading it, but because it's a thriller, they do read it, which I think is awesome when it works, and then when it doesn't work, I'm like, well, it's not for you, you Republican.
That's the blur of them.
But it's for everyone. Everyone's welcome at this party.
Masterful twist. We gotta get to go. We could probably do one more question. Yes.
So I found the strong element of torture in the book. And at the same time, it was kind of a torture that you couldn't stop watching or that I couldn't turn away from. So if I was to say, do a compare and contrast, I read part of The Snow Leopard and I ultimately.
Second time it's come up tonight. Yeah.
Is it really? Funny?
Yeah.
So, and I put it down after the first chapter because I thought, you know what, I'm not into people being tortured. And it's not entertainment for me on any level. And the torture preceded the plot, so I think that made it harder in The Snow Leopard.
Yeah.
And what I found in your book, or in this one, Every Damn Menace, was less. For some reason, less sympathy for many of the characters compared to the white man, where I had a lot of sympathy for many of them. And in this one, at the end, I just felt incredibly depressed.
See?
I was depressed.
Yeah.
I had to really work through it for about 48 hours to figure out where it was coming from. Part of the depression was having to let go of this incredibly spellbinding story.
That's your other blurb.
Yeah. I was kind of depressed. I mean, it's kind of a depressing book, but I'm glad that it made you feel something, you know, as opposed to just being like, I don't feel anything. I think feeling depressed is good, you know? I felt depressed when I wrote it. it's a depressing story, but you know, that's how it goes.
But it is riveting.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the best depressing stories out there.
Action packed, depressing. Well, let's wind it down on that. Thank you, Patrick Hoffman.